train differently. An old-time fighter, Hagler. He trains at Provincetown on Cape Cod. Then he went to Palm Springs and closed his workouts to the public. Hearns came in to Miami Beach and then moved right in here to Caesar's Palace and had open sessions. In fact, he led Arabic dancing in the ring with six beauties there. It sort of reminds you of Muhammad Ali in his training days. But they're all set now. They want to get to it, and we're going to get right down to ringside to Al Michaels and Al Bernstein.
All right, Kurt, well, everybody's been talking about it. Hearns has certain hands beating the jab and power and all of that, and Hagler is more resolute, and there are a million different factors involved here, and that's why there's been so much talk about who will win. For each man to win, what has to happen? What's the key for each man?
I think for Thomas Hearns, he wants to establish his jab. It's very important, and be able to drop the right hand in. He thinks that he can do that against Hagler, and he thinks that he can keep Hagler on the outside by doing that. For Marvin Hagler, the key is to get by that jab, not just get by it, but get inside and then work to the body of that man, Thomas Hearns, and then eventually get to the head. I think the wild card is, will Marvin Hagler switch to righty effectively? If he does that, it might be the key to a victory for him.
As is customary, it is the challenger who enters first into this Hagler's title. Even though Tommy has won two titles, he does not own the middleweight crown that he seeks tonight, and thus he is the first to come in. And the long wait is over, as accompanied by the entourage, he is out of the dressing room and about ready to enter the arena. He's been lighthearted, basically. Kurt talking about the aerobic dancing and bringing folks into the ring and the open sparring sessions and open workouts. Quite serious right now, though, is Thomas Hearns.
And appropriately entering the ring to hail to the victors of the Michigan fight song.
Still not in view of most here in the arena yet is Hearns, so no response as yet, but very shortly he will be approaching that part of the arena here at Caesar's Palace just about now, where they're beginning to take notice of the entry of Thomas Hearns as he comes down the aisle.
The second time Thomas Hearns has had this kind of situation. The last time, of course, against Sugar Ray Leonard. He hopes this turns out differently.
Now he's spotted. Up the steps he comes. And into the ring he comes. Thomas Hearns. The only loss, of course, to Sugar Ray Leonard back in 1981, a fight in which he was ahead.
He had shown his boxing skills in that fight against Leonard, and many think they may come into play tonight. If Hagler would hurt him early, as Leonard did, that man, Thomas Hearns, has the speed to get on his bicycle and duplicate what he did against Leonard, at least for a certain portion of those fights. He'd like a first-round knockout here. He says he'll do it in three. We'll see.
Took Duran out in two. Thomas Hearns in the ring and awaiting Marvin Hagler, who loves to, among other things, make people wait.
He is renowned, as you see, the very able corner of Thomas Hearns. And you know, when he fought Sugar Ray Leonard, Al, there was criticism of Emmanuel Stewart. Normally a very calm corner for Thomas Hearns. On that night, the most pressure-packed of his career, there was some chaos in that corner. Emmanuel says, we learned from our mistakes with Leonard, and we feel we've got it all together now.
I'm curious as to the response when Hagler comes in. I thought it was sort of muted in a way. There was some cheering for Hearns, but nothing outrageous by any stretch of the imagination. Could just be a muted crowd right now. We're going to find out.
It's possible, or in fact, Hagler is the favorite of the crowd.
Yeah.
Which would be odd, considering that, as you said, the betting money has switched back and forth. And if you talk, as I said, if you talk to any 10 people, you're going to find five for Hearns, five for Hagler. So it's been a very divided group of people here in Las Vegas, and I suspect around the country as well. Here he comes.
Marvelous Marvin Hagler, out of Newark originally, now Brockton, Massachusetts, coming in. to a mixed response. One theory is, for those who think Hagler will win, they say maybe this fight means a little bit more to Hagler than it does to Hearns. It means a lot, obviously, to both. But that theory goes that Marvin feels he'll never get the respect he's due unless he beats Thomas Hearns.
And he is, of course, chasing the record of Carlos Monzon, looking for the 14th consecutive title defenses. He has 10 now. He's shooting for number 11. And indeed, the response to Marvin Hagler seems to be a little bit more than Thomas Hearns.
It is. It is. A bigger hand for Hagler coming in, for what that's worth, than for the headman.
When he came in against Roberto Duran in his last big fight, it was just the opposite. So perhaps Marvin Hagler finally getting his due from boxing fans who on occasion have been indifferent to him.
Bob Arum, the promoter, called him the Pete Rose of boxing. Hardworking, resolute, single-minded, 62-2. The two losses early in his career, both in Philadelphia, both avenged, 50 knockouts.
And it's been a long time since he knew what the word defeat was. Only the draw with Antifermo, any kind of stain on his record in recent years. And he certainly avenged that draw. A look at the tail of the tape, it tells you what you know probably already about the big reach advantage, the height advantage for Thomas Hearns, and that's a key element in this fight. But for Marvin Hagler, he expects to get inside against Hearns, and if he doesn't do that, could have a long night.
Can he possibly win if he doesn't get inside?
Well, he could if he catches Hearns on the end of one of his punches, perhaps a left hook. I think that's where him switching righty becomes a key factor. From the outside, I think he's much more effective as a righty. The common opponents, an indication there that Hearns, perhaps with more power, but Marcus Giraldo was not the fighter he was against Hearns that he was against Hagler, and that knockout of Duran. So you can look on and on. The number of punches, these are two fighters who will throw a lot of punches tonight. You see Marvin Hagler throws a lot. He's got a good jab, good combination puncher. The same is true of Thomas Hearns. Look at the number of punches he throws. A lot of left jabs snaking out there.
So the pomp and ceremony still taking place. We're going to have the national anthem shortly. Al, here's the difference now. From Nevada, we go to WBC rules.
And these will change somewhat. 10-point must system still in effect. There is no three knockdown rule. There is no standing eight count. You saved by the bell only in the last round. Again, the three judges will score the fight. International judges, the referee, or the ring doctor can stop the fight.
Right now, let's go to the ring and Chuck Hull.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would direct your attention to the lighted tower, the fantasy tower at Caesar's Palace, just to the northeast of us, and you will see unfurled the largest American flag in the world. The flag was created by Mr. Ski Demski. And now it gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce a very talented young man as I ask you to rise, please, as our national anthem will be presented by Doc Severinsen. attention, ladies and gentlemen, the color guard from the Marine Corps Reserve here in Las Vegas. Gentlemen, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, the officials assigned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission for the next event of the evening. The judges are Dick Young of Los Angeles, California, Herb Santos of Reno, Nevada, and Harry Gibbs of England. The timekeeper is Charlie Roth. Counting at the knockdowns, Jane Broadfoot. The attending physicians at ringside, Drs. Donald Romeo, Flip Omansky, and Charles Filippini. Your referee for the next event of the evening is Mr. Richard Steele. This is the main event of the night. 12 rounds of boxing for the undisputed middleweight championship of the world. Introducing, in the red corner, the challenger, the WBC super welterweight champion, fighting out of Detroit, Michigan, weighing 159 and 3/4 pounds. His professional record consists of 40 wins, one defeat, with 34 KOs. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Thomas the Hitman Hearns. And in the blue corner, fighting out of Brockton, Massachusetts, weighing 159 and 1/4 pounds, with a professional record of 60 wins, 2 defeats, 2 draws, and 50 KOs. Ladies and gentlemen, the undisputed middleweight champion of the world, Marvelous Marvin Hagler.
All right, Pat, good eight, let's go.
So the two come
okay,
to
I gave both
Richard
fighters
Steele.
The instructions in the dress room. I'm just cautioning you now. Obey my command at all times. Shake hands, good luck to both of you. Let's go.
Very simple instructions. And finally, it's Hagler against Hearns.
The camera's gonna have to go.
Eloquent simplicity by Richard Steele. Let's go.
He knows, they know. Staring at each other through the national anthem.
The camera
stare down,
be
of course, so customary before these fights. And here we go. Round one. Hagler, right off the bat, attempting to get inside. He'd love to be able to pin Hearns on the ropes if he can.
A more aggressive start by Hagler. Look at him right for the body. Marvin Hagler only wants the body. He bangs Marvin. Oh, Hearns whip out with the right hand.
Right out of the right. Hearns hits him with an uppercut. Hagler, he's Hearns hurt. Hagler is done. Hearns got inside. Hit him with a right uppercut. Marvin ties him up.
Marvin Hagler is still hurt.
So it was Hagler coming in. Look at the ball. A good left by Hagler. And Hearns didn't flinch. Marvin going for the body. Wild first round.
Wow, what a shot. And it was Hagler who initiated it, not Thomas Hearns.
And a left by Hagler. What a first minute of the fight.
Tommy Hearns has been able to drop that right hand in, and it has hurt Hagler, a surprise to many people.
Another right hand from Hearns. Hearns moving. Hagler still pursuing. Comes in with a right. Hits him with a left hook.
Here's where I believe Hagler should turn to right. He could block that right hand easier, and he would land his own left hook.
Devastating punch. Swelling. Here Hagler's left eye again. Tommy trying to come inside the hands of Hagler.
Low blow by Hearns. Hagler's still looking for the body.
A right by Hagler. Good right got in. He has Hearns where he'd love to keep on the ropes, but Tommy comes off easily. Another good right by Hearns.
Hagler's now shaking those right hands off, though, Al. He was stung a little early, and he's normally a slow starter.
He's also bleeding. Hagler is cut. Hagler is cut. Hearns in the nose.
He is banging the body well. He is taking shots to the head.
He blocks that right. Hearns tries to come in with the uppercut. And Hagler ties him up with a minute to go in a wild first round.
Drink the water right now, Pat.
The cut is over the right eye of Marvin Hagler. It's hard to tell him. It's not on the eyelid, though. It looks to me on his forehead. That may not be as much of a problem. As we look at it, that was where it came, I believe, for that uppercut from Tommy Hearns. That was early in the round, but now later, Marvin Hagler digging to the body and throwing a right hook. Fought most of that round, in fact, all of it as a southpaw. He took the action to Hearns, a surprise early.
Well, the first round lived up to all the hype, and then so. Round two now. Left hand by Hagler.
They said this fight would be determined on heart and the good chin. Right now, that's exactly what it's being determined on. Both men have been hurt. You can throw the strategy out the window right now.
A wild first round.
Hearns
again trying to uppercut. Hearns trying to box. Moving. Slipping off the ropes. Coming back and trying to land that right.
They are yelling, "Keep boxing, Tommy," from his corner. And that is looks like what he's going to try and do in this fight.
Hearns, off balance. His foot was stepped on. Not
Hagler,
close to a knockdown.
Excuse me, Al. Hagler turns righty. I think this could be a key moment in this fight.
First time, Hagler switching. Gets in with the left hand. This round sort of the way people anticipated the first round might go. Another right hand stuns Hearns. The crowd, of course, emphatic over every punch that's thrown. Hagler, despite that reach disadvantage, has been able to get into Hearns, more so I think most people expected.
For one simple reason, good left hook by Hagler. He took the best hand Hearns could offer, and he did come in. He's getting through that right hand, even though he's getting hit with it.
Halfway through, round two.
Hagler's fought most of this round as a righty. Now he switches southpaw and lands. Not as effective as a righty as I thought, but now it's a southpaw. The jab lands well.
That right jab.
Punching it out. Punching it out.
Left.
Step back.
A key element now is Hagler is working when he's on the inside. He's not just holding. He is working the body of Tommy Hearns. Boy, Hearns looks awkward. His legs look like they're not there.
A little rubbery here in round two. Tommy, though, fluid and moving. Trying to get inside again. The cut opens up over Hagler's.
Go, hold him! Go, hold him!
And the blood begins to trickle down.
Punching it out.
Hagler working.
Let him go,
inside
let him go.
Now, up top. Half a minute to go in round two.
Off one left.
Hearns training. Hagler just got to the right. Left. And another right. He has Hearns in trouble on the ropes. Tommy trying to punch his way off the ropes. Hagler wants to keep him there. Goes to the body.
Hagler throws low blows. Marvin Hagler wants to turn this into an alley walk. And he's got another low blow. Richard Steele may take points away soon. But will it matter?
Second round coming to an end. Hagler bloody, but very much unbound. End of round two.
Keep your hands up low. When you finish up with the shot, move off to one side or the other, okay? You're not boxing to be in out here. Try to work on letting him miss with the left and going over here and then coming back with the right.
You got to cut up there.
Just box him. Stay away and box him. Let's get your second win and relax like nothing had to do with Colin Jones. Let's think carefully. Let's box it. When you get through with your shot, move off to one side or the other. You're getting it on tail end punches. You understand?
You can hear Manny Stewart talking to Hearns.
They want to get the cut on Hagler. You had him going.
And the Petronelli's good cut men. Goody and Pat have done excellent job
like
on the cuts
now.
Of Hagler.
Pumping,
what a
okay?
shock that that man okay. initiated this war right from the beginning. Right? And you know what? I thought he would do well as a righty. He has done better as a southpaw, and he may stay at that.
Again, Stewart telling Hearns to box. As you say, though, Hagler turning it into a street fight.
Well, he turns righty. He wants it to be a street fight. Listen, Marvin Hagler has been rough inside. He's thrown some low blows. He has thrown some elbows.
Don't push.
But you know what? Now the right is getting there, but it's not hurting Hagler. We've got our answer, I think, to some extent. Tommy has been hard-pressed to hurt him with that right. Stunned him early, but not in the last round or two.
Very early. as he becomes off balance. Some thought that if Hearns stayed on his side and stayed on his bicycle, it would become a dull fight with Marvin chasing him. But Marvin has been able to corner him, and when Marvin gets in the corner, he is roughhousing him well. Again, Hagler is all bloody. Time is called by Richard Steele to send Hagler over to the ring doctor.
It's not Marvin.
He's calling the ring doctor in.
Let him go.
The last thing in the world Hagler wants is the fight to be stopped. The doctor looks at it. Back comes Hagler with a wild left hand. It has to be impeding his vision with the right eye. He's having another go. Tremendous right. Hearns appears rubbery. He appeared that way in the second round.
You know, Richard Steele is breaking these fighters very quickly. That's uncharacteristic of him. It's hurting Hagler because he wants to work inside. Hearns is smiling, but he's taking shots.
Another right hand. Hearns turns his back, takes another right. Hearns in deep trouble again. Hearns is down. Hearns is down in the third round and on his back. And he's not going to beat the count. I don't believe. Tommy Hearns tries to get up, and he...
They've got
to
stop this fight.
Does he get up? He just does not. He can't continue. It's Hagler, full of blood. Blood, no doubt, impeding his vision. Stopping under the third round after Hearns almost ended it on a first-round knockout. It didn't go very far, but it was a beauty.
And Tommy Hearns predicted a knockout in the third. Instead, it is Marvin Hagler, and we certainly hope Tommy Hearns will be all right. He is still wobbly. What a shot. Instead of Hearns initiating wild early action, it is this man who, believe me, has gained any redemption he needed from the loss to Roberto Duran.
Marvelous Marvin Hagler. So close to being knocked out in the first round. Withstood the barrage. You'd have to figure he lost round one, came back round two, despite the deep cut time called by Richard Steele in round three. Ring doctor observes, comes back, knocks him out in round three. So it's Marvelous Marvin Hagler, 61, 2-2. Another look as we watch it at the end. Hagler with that right hand, that lunging right hand. Hearns turning his back on him, and then you'll see Hagler come in and deliver a right to the side of the head. Hearns backing off again, taking the right hand. Legs gone at that point. Down on his back. Got up at the count of 10. That was the end of it. Different angle. Hearns, whose legs became rubbery in the second round, having trouble with his balance in round three. Turning his back. Another right hand from Hagler. But at this point, the damage had been done. Finishing right there. But Hearns was on his way down anyway. Only disappointment is that it didn't go longer. What a three rounds. Different angle again now. Right hand from Hagler. And Hearns at that point finished. Off balance and stumbling. And so the man from Brockton, Massachusetts may finally get the respect that he feels he deserves. And acclaimed as one of the greatest middleweights in history. Doing nothing to dispute that tonight. Shaking off some thunderous blows in round one. Withstanding the barrage. Suffering the cut. Coming back strong in round two. Finishing them in round three. Hearns right above us in the corner. Tommy still shaking. Tommy on his stool. And Tommy, of course, very disappointed. Frustrated as Marvin Hagler, Marvelous Marvin Hagler, the legal name, retains the undisputed middleweight title. And let's go to Al Bernstein.
Marvin Hagler in a chaotic ring here. He says, am I the greatest? And I guess so, Marvin. Marvin, it was, I guess, one of the best three-round fights ever, maybe one of the
did
best middleweights.
I
guess you did. All here right. Comes Tommy Hearns to say congratulations.
Yeah, we gave him a hell of a show out here. They got their money worth.
All right, we're happy to see that Tommy's all right. And a lot of congratulations all around and a lot of water as well. Marvin, you took the action to Tommy right away. You went right for his body. He looked like he stunned you momentarily with a right in the first. Did that right hurt you?
It didn't bother me. It just made me madder.
Okay.
I told you I was going to eat him up like Pac-Man.
I figured once I get through the right hand, then it was all mine, you know, because I think the first big one, what you tried, tried to put me away out there, and I think that's when I got the cut there, but I wanted to show the world I am the greatest now.
Well, you are the greatest middleweight. There's no doubt about that.
Did I say three?
You went right for the body. Was that your plan immediately?
That was the way we planned. I want to thank all my sparring partners. Especially, I want to thank God for giving me the strength and the courage and the confidence to go in here and to know that I was the one. I was the champion, but I had to fight like a challenger.
That fight, I think, took tremendous courage on your part for this reason. You walked right in against the cannon. You were willing to take the right hand to knock him out.
You got it. I figured I had to take punches or to give some, but I told you he was going to get some, too.
This was, in some ways, not like the Marvin Hagler we've often seen. Not the ring technician. You bombed.
That's it. That's what I felt. I felt as though in every one of my fights I've been fighting, I improved, and I put it all together in this fight.
The Petronelli's here. I guess you've got to be just thrilled with this. It's probably your biggest moment.
The greatest. There's this guy. There's he. Now that we take care of the wise guys.
The hurt man.
The hurt man, the hit man. We love him.
I want to say to all the people out there who spent their money, I hope that you got your money's worth, because Tommy's a hell of a fighter, and I think I put all my all out here, but the better man won tonight.
You have talked about going after Monzon's record. Is it still on your mind? And I guess this just fuels you. Getting that record might put you in that class of the greatest middleweight.
Definitely. I'm still after Monzon's record, but I don't think that I'll have a big media hype as I did with this one. So I'm going to continue. Okay. This is one of my toughest fights.
Marvin, congratulations.
Thank you.
Let's go back to Kurt Gowdy.
There's been a lot of talk about Hagler retiring. His wife, Bertha's here. There are four children, and she wants him to retire. When they ask...
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Richard Steele stops the bout at 2 minutes, 1 second of the third round. The winner by a TKO and still undisputed middleweight champion of the world, Marvelous Marvin Hagler.
So official at 2:01, round three. Hagler saying he hopes everybody got their money's worth. It was a great 8 minutes. It was a great 8:01.
It was an incredible fight. And for Marvin Hagler, I'll tell you what, he did the unexpected, Al. He walked right into the cannons that Tommy Hearns had. He said, I'm going to take what I have to take in order to bomb my way to victory. It was uncharacteristic, but it was exciting, and it was a man looking to gain ultimate respect from the boxing community.
I found it fascinating in a way that you said to him, were you hurt? When we sit here at ringside, and I don't know, sometimes it's a little distorted on television, you knew he was hurt when Hearns hit him, and yet he said, no, it just made me mad, but you knew he was hurt.
I think he was certainly stunned in any case, and I think the fact of the matter is that he was not hurt to the point where Marvin Hagler goes down. Well, Marvin Hagler just doesn't go down. This is a man with such incredible grit and such courage. I just don't think you can say enough about that, because he went in against a very good puncher, welterweight, junior, middle, took the best he could offer, and just his determination and heart won it.
Some thought that he would take Hearns' best shot and leer at him or grin at him. He certainly didn't do that. He was stunned by it, but he was able to withstand it, win the second round, knock him out in the third, and let's go up to Kurt.
Talking about being down, you know, Hagler was pulled down against Juan Roldan in March of this year, and they protested that knockdown. They viewed the fight and ruled that it was not a knockdown. So Hagler has never been down in his career. And now he's gone 9 years without a defeat. We were talking about the retirement. You've been reading his wife, Bertha, is here with her four children and wants him to retire. And Hagler simply says, that's wife talk. With me is one of the great matchmakers of all time, Teddy Brenner of Top Rank. What about it? Did you ever see better three rounds than that, Teddy?
That was three of the greatest rounds I ever saw. I always called Marvin. I'm very friendly with him. I said, Marvin, from tonight on, Marvelous is the only way I'll address him. He was magnificent.
Well, you're a matchmaker. Did this matchup, but you would think all the hype and everything?
Everything. Nobody could pick a winner. If you met 50 people, 25 said Hagler, 25 said Hearns. It was really everything that I ever thought a fight could possibly be. Drama, excitement, and courage right out there on the line.
What'd you think about the strategy? They just came out and wailed away. And right from the opening 3 or 4 seconds, the first blow, this crowd was roaring and on his feet here at Caesars Palace.
That's correct. The only way Hagler could possibly win was to go right out, bring it to him, and fight him. And that's the way he did it.
You think Hearn made any kind of mistake?
Well, Hearn's mistake was he couldn't do anything but stand there because Hagler gave him no room. He had to fight Hagler's fight. Hagler made the tempo of the fight, and Hearns just wasn't physically strong enough.
Hagler mentioned Monzon, the Argentinian, who defended his title 14 times, and now that is Hagler's goal. He wants to beat that mark. This was his 11th defense tonight, so he'll be going after Monzon's record.
He was absolutely magnificent. I don't think words can properly describe how Hagler fought. He was great.
All right, that's Brennan. You'll be making more matches. Will there be a rematch of this one?
I don't know if Hearns is ready for a rematch, but Hagler's ready. As soon as that cut heals, he's ready to climb into the ring again.
Thank you, Teddy. Let's go down now to Al Michaels.
Okay, Kurt, so Teddy Brenner, who has seen a few fights in his time, saw three of the greatest rounds of boxing, little doubt about it. And since this one ended early, we can go back and view it in its entirety. And we'll go back and replay it for you, beginning with round one and the original commentary. Mr. Murray, before these fights, and here we go.
Hagler, he's on his heart. Hagler is shot. the water right now, Pat.
The cut is over the right eye of Marvin Hagler. It's hard to tell. It's not on the eyelid, though. It looks to me on his forehead. That may not be as much of a cut. As we look at it, that was where it came, I believe, from that uppercut from Tommy Hearns. That was early in the round, but now later. Marvin Hagler digging to the body and throwing a right hook. Fought most of that round, in fact, all of it is a southpaw. He took the action to Hearns, a surprise early.
Well, the first round lived up to all the hype, and then so. Round two now.
Oh,
the left hand by Hagler.
They said this fight would be determined on heart and the good chin. Right now, that's exactly what it's being determined on. Both men have been hurt. You can throw the strategy out the window right now.
Watch your foot.
A wild first
don't
round.
Hold it, don't
Hearns
hold it.
Again trying to uppercut. Hearns trying to box. Moving. Slipping off the ropes. Coming back and trying to land that right.
They are yelling, keep boxing, Tommy, from his corner. And that is looks like what he's going to try and do in this fight. Excuse me, Al. Hagler turns righty. I think this could be a key moment in this fight.
For the first time, Hagler switching, gets into the left hand. This round sort of the way people anticipated the first round.
Yes.
Another right hand stuns Hearns. The crowd, of course, emphatic over every punch that's thrown. Hagler, despite that reach disadvantage, has been able to get into Hearns, more so than I think most people expected.
For one simple reason, good left hook by Hagler. He took the best hand Hearns could offer, and he did come in. He's getting through that right hand, even though he's getting hit with it.
Halfway through, round two.
Hagler has fought most of this round as a righty. Now he switches southpaw and lands. Not as effective as a righty as I thought, but now it's a southpaw. The jab lands well.
That right jab.
Punch it, get out. Punch it, get out. Great. Step back. Step back.
Punch your way out. Punch your way out.
A key element now is Hagler is working when he's on the inside. He's not just holding. He is working the body of Tommy Hearns. Hearns looks awkward. His legs look like they're not there.
A little rubbery here in round two. Tommy, though, fluid and moving. Trying to get inside again. The cut opens up for Hagler's.
Don't hold him. Don't hold him.
And the blood begins to trickle down.
Let's get out.
Hagler working inside now.
Hagler throws low blows. Marvin Hagler wants to turn this into an alley war, and he's good. Another low blow. Richard Steele may take points away soon. Will it matter?
Second round coming to an end. Hagler bloody, but very much unbound. End of round two.
Keep your hands up low. When you finish up with the shot, move off to one side or the other, okay?
You got to cut a band.
Just boxing. Stay away from boxing. Just boxing. Just get your second wind and relax like nothing had to do with Colin Jones. Just think carefully. Just boxing. When you get through with your shot, move off to one side or the other. You're getting hit on tail end punches. You understand?
You can hear Manny Stewart talking to Hearns.
Don't worry about the cut on Hagler.
You had him going.
And the Petronelli's good cut man. Goody and Pat have done excellent job on the cuts of Hagler. What a shock that that man initiated this war right from the beginning. And you know what? I thought he would do well as a righty. He has done better as a southpaw, and he may stay at that.
Again, Stewart telling Hearns to box. As you say, though, Hagler turning it into a street fight.
Well, he turns righty. He wants it to be a street fight. Listen, Marvin Hagler has been rough inside. He's thrown some low blows. He has thrown some elbows.
Don't push. Don't push.
But you know what? Now the right is getting there, but it's not hurting Hagler. We've got our answer, I think, to some extent. Tommy has been hard-pressed to hurt him with that right. Stunned him early, but not in the last round or two.
Very early. Adam Sun has him cut. But it was Hagler doing the damage in round two.
And now
little thought as he becomes off balance, some thought that if Hearns stays outside, if Stanton on his bicycle will become his own fight, and Marvin chasing him.
But Marvin has been able to corner him, and when Marvin gets him in the corner, he is roughhousing him well.
Again, Hagler is all bloodied. Time is called by Richard Steele to send Hagler over to the ring doctor.
It's not Marvin.
He's calling the ring doctor in.
Side, let him go.
The last thing in the world Hagler wants is the fight to be stopped. The doctor looks at it. Back comes Hagler with a wild left hand. It has to be impeding his vision for the right eye. He never knows it though. Tremendous right. Hearns appears rubbery. He appeared that way in the second round.
You know, Richard Steele is breaking these fighters very quickly. That's uncharacteristic of him. It's hurting Hagler because he wants to work inside. Hearns is smiling, but he's taking shots.
Another right hand. Hearns turns his back, takes another right. Hearns in deep trouble again. Hearns is down. Hearns is down in the third round and on his back. And he's not going to make the count. I don't believe. Tommy Hearns tries to get up. And he...
They've got to stop this fight.
Does he get up? He just does not. He can't continue. It's Hagler full of blood. Blood, no doubt, impeding his vision. Stopping him in the third round after Hearns almost ended it on a first-round knockout. It didn't go very far, but it was a beauty.
And Tommy Hearns predicted a knockout in the third. Instead, it is Marvin Hagler, and we certainly hope Tommy Hearns will be all right. He is still wobbly. What a shock. Instead of Hearns initiating wild early action, it is this man who, believe me, has gained any redemption he needed from the loss of Roberto Duran.
Marvelous Marvin Hagler. So close to being knocked out in the first round. Twisted the mirage. You'd have to figure he lost round one, came back round two, despite the deep cut time call by Richard Steele in round three. Ring doctor observes, comes back, knocks him out in round three. So it's Marvelous Marvin Hagler, 61, 2-2. Another look as we watch it at the end. Hagler with that right hand, that lunging right hand. Hearns turning his back on him, and then you'll see Hagler come in and deliver a right to the side of the head. Hearns backing off again.
Trying to take it away.
And so we're back live now after you have viewed the replay of the Hagler-Hearns 8-minute confrontation, ending at 2-0-1 officially, third round. Technical knockout scored by Marvin Hagler. Hagler was able to take Hearns' best shot despite being stunned in the first round. Tommy could not take advantage of it. And Hagler figured to have won round two, even though we have not seen the official scorecards as yet. It was toward the end of round two when you noticed the rubbery legs of Hearns for the first time. And as you look at fight stat, total punches thrown by Hagler in 8 minutes, 173. So that's better than 20 punches a minute, as was the case with Tommy Hearns. The percentage is about even right there, so not much disparity. But when you think about that, that's 20 punches per minute basically through the fight, or one about every 3 seconds in what Hagler, as Al Bernstein said, turned into a street fight, exactly the way he wanted it. Hearns, by the time he was able to attempt to box and get outside and try to stay away, it was too late. He'd been hurt. The legs were rubbery, and down he went. So chances are, even though it was a great, great fight, you would not think there would be a great outcry for a rematch in light of the fact that Hagler was dominant. It was a very exciting 8 minutes. It was something that the people here at Caesars Palace and those viewing on television will remember for quite some time, but there was little doubt who is the better fighter, as Marvelous Marvin